You have not seen me talk about Hakeem because, in general, I try to avoid talking about Hakeem. I love what Hakeem does, the versatility on defense, the post moves on offense, but I actually have a different take that I do feel he's become overrated as time has gone on. One of the things I do with my matrix is I track rankings across times, and one of the things you'll see with Hakeem is that he is straight level, which is weird because if you look at some of these rankings, they're pre-Kobe, Duncan, and LeBron really rising up, pre-Curry, pre-Durant. And one would expect as those guys rise, they start taking over spots held by some of those mid-10 to teen players. But for Hakeem, instead of him falling back, they start pushing guys who were ahead of him behind him. And we can see that happen with Oscar Robertson or Jerry West, who were pretty universally rated as higher than him, are now rated lower than him. Now, I will say I agree with having Hakeem over those two. It's just interesting that he has maintained levelness while other guys have slid behind him. Another thing that I think has helped Hakeem with these rankings and with the general perception around the basketball public is this idea that he always was what he was in 94 and 95. In general, I feel like we gloss over the fact that from 87 to 92, there's a debate who's better, him or Patrick Ewing. And in that time period, even when Hakeem wins first team All-NBA, he's usually not considered a top five player. He's somewhere in that 6 to 10 range. And a big part of this is that while his offensive game is beautiful, he's got all of these moves and fakes, he's kind of a black hole on offense. He catches it and the ball doesn't come back out. Also, having a deep bag doesn't entirely make him that efficient of an offensive player. I want you to think about guys like Carmelo Anthony or Kobe Bryant, who have this beautiful jab step game that you can watch highlights of where they take guys all the time. But end of the day, 2 points is 2 points, and if a guy is hitting them more efficiently at the same volume, that guy's probably a better scorer than you. And this happens with Hakeem all the time. We fall in love with the dream shake, and we think he's one of the best scorers in the league, but really he's just a little bit above league average in efficiency despite all of the moves. And nowadays, you'll see people say that Hakeem is the best defensive player of all time. You don't really see that through the early 90s. At that time, it's still very debated. Is it him, Robinson, or Ewing? Also, a couple other guys, Dikembe Mutombo, Mark Eaton. It's not like he didn't have help on the defensive end. And 91, when Hakeem is sitting out, faking an injury, demanding a trade, the Rockets are still the second best defensive team in the league while he misses 26 games. And I know it sounds like all I've done is just kind of pick on Hakeem and nitpick, and that's what you have to do when you are looking at the top 10 to 15 players, which I do believe Hakeem is in that range. But it does matter to me, and I think it should be a knock against his defense, that he is 1-4 against teams who primary post score with Sam Perkins. But before we get to the magical run of 94, I do want to kind of talk about what's changed. Because at this point, you've got Rudy Tomjanovich in there, who is doing a masterful job coaching. If you want his case for being top 15 coach, it's this. He revamps the offense, he figures out how to get more spacing, more shooting, which gives Hakeem more time to have his head up. Hakeem vastly improves as a passer during that time period. And along with that, he's able to use his footwork for more than just scoring, his playmaking as well. In the magical 94 run, you do hear a lot about how Hakeem wins without another All-Star. And that's kind of true. Otis Thorpe was an All-Star in 92, but I get what you mean. But that fails to take into context just how many All-Stars there were and who all he went against. The Portland team he beats is Clyde Drexler and Rod Strickland. Strickland is not an All-Star. In the second round, he plays Phoenix, and this is probably the best team. This is probably the team that is projected to make it back to the finals after getting there in 93. And while they have two legitimate All-Stars, they're using 6'9" AC Green to defend Hakeem this entire series. And while Hakeem does not have a second All-Star, he receives a big game from a different role player each of the 4 wins Houston has. This Houston team is a conglomerate of really good players. I want you to think closer to the Denver Nuggets of this past year than like a traditional no All-Stars team. In the Western Conference Finals, he takes down the Jazz. They were the 5 seed. They're pretty much just happy to be there. They're also starting Felton Spencer at center, and this just is not a center matchup worthy of the game. Then in the finals, they go up against a 3 All-Star team. But the 3 All-Stars are Patrick Ewing, who Patrick and Hakeem, that's okay, fair matchup. Charles Oakley. Oakley versus Otis Thorpe. Yes, one guy is an All-Star this year and the other guy was an All-Star 2 years prior, but those guys are about even. And then John Starks. And yes, John Starks is better than Vernon Maxwell or Kenny the Jet Smith, but I would say the combination of the two of them, you're about on par. And that's about what we see. This series goes 7 games. And the Knicks have a shot to win it in the end, and I just want to ask you, the people who rate Hakeem super high, if the Knicks win this series, Are you going to flip Hakeem and Patrick Ewing? Hopefully not. Hopefully this one series doesn't make that big of a difference in your rankings of him. I could do something similar for the 95 run, but we're already like 5 minutes long, and I don't think anyone's going to watch to this point anymore. So I'll just suffice it to say that that year, yes, they don't have another All-Star, but Clyde Drexler's third-team All-NBA, he had been a multi-time All-Star, and he is the 1B to the Rockets that year. The team was not good throughout the regular season. Hakeem could not get them back to that same level they were at the previous year, and that's why they have one of the quote-unquote toughest runs, because they were a bad regular season team. So I know it's been 6 minutes of me picking nits at Hakeem's career, but I love Hakeem. I love all that he does well. I just think we gloss over all of these flaws and holes too much. And I don't see a case for him to be a better big man than Bill Russell, Shaquille, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, or Tim Duncan. I'll accept a case against him or Wilt, because they both kind of have that flaw of they get a lot of great numbers early, but they don't figure out how to translate that into winning.